morning again, everyone. Welcome, moms. Those of you who aren't usually here during the summer, I've seen some faces that I haven't seen since a few months before Ashley and I got started here. So it's good to see everybody. I look forward to getting to know all of the summer attenders better as the weeks go on and the months go on. This morning, I'd like to begin with a word of prayer. We bow together. Lord Jesus, your name truly is above every name. I hope we never get tired of singing your name. I hope we never grow complacent, Lord. I hope we never forget the power that's in that name. Help us, God, if we do. Remind us every day of the glory that's contained within the name of Jesus, spoken by a people group from every tribe, tongue, and nation in the whole world. That name is just different from any other name. It's the name which gives our life meaning and purpose. And so, God, we're here to worship that name, to proclaim it, to make it famous. And I pray that this message would do just that. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Today's message is entitled, Standing by the Cross. And we're taking a one-week hiatus from our series in Genesis. If you notice on your bulletins, I didn't tell Ray or Ashley enough time to change the bulletin cover. So it still says Genesis on the cover. That's because we've been going through a sermon series in Genesis. But this is a different message today. Today we're going to be in the book of John. And as I said, it's a message aimed directly at the heart of moms. I've been thinking a lot about my mother lately. My wife, as she is still learning to be a mother. Our kids are still young, 6 and 8 years old. And this whole week, I thought a lot about the great sacrifices that my mom made, that my grandmother made as I was growing up, and my sister, and my sisters-in-law, and all the ways that they've ministered to me as I've grown. And I found a passage in John that really helped me to worship better this week. It helped me to appreciate my own mother and my wife a lot better. So I hope, my aim is that it will do the same for you today. I hope that it's encouragement to moms, but also an exhortation to just continue pursuing Jesus in your motherhood. Okay? I want to show you some pictures as we get started. Won't put the first one up just yet, Frank. These are pictures of my children, so do not get caught up in their cuteness. That's not why I'm showing them to you. I'm going to show you just 10 pictures of my kids. Now, as I said, they're 6 and 8 years old. Some of you, your children haven't been 6 or 8 in decades and decades. Some of you have 60-year-old kids. Here's the reason I want to show you these pictures. I want to show you them because they're precious to Ashley and I. They're memories that we hold on to so tightly because they're really what life's made up of. Life is just a series of memories, and we keep them stored in our memory bank. Memory is a precious thing. So as you look through these 10 photos of my kids, I hope that you'll be able to go back in your memory bank, if you have children, moms especially, I want you to scroll through those memory banks. Now, Ashley and I have a lot to learn from you. Our children are so young, we haven't really experienced much of parenthood yet. Only 8 years of it, almost 9. We haven't experienced the teenage years yet. We haven't walked anybody down the aisle. We haven't experienced some of the hardships all of you have, so we're still learning. We're still watching how you parent your grown children. And so I hope, as you look at these 10 pictures, I want you to scroll through and remember what it was like when you had small children. Okay? Let's put the first one up. 3 seconds for each picture. That's Logan. There's Peyton doing what she probably shouldn't have been doing. He did that. First day of school. That's one of my favorites. Take a look at that. Leave that one up there for a bit. Anybody's child ever ate a marker before? I hope you have those moments. I hope you have those moments that you can just scroll through when you're alone and relive them again, because they are precious moments. Jesus was the Son of God, right? We know that. Full of power and majesty, strength. He was divine, superhuman. but he was also the son of Mary. That part of his character doesn't get as much attention as the Son of God part. But the Son of Mary means that he was also full of pain. He was full of temptation. He knew hardship. He knew what it was to suffer long before the cross. Because just as he was perfectly divine, he was also perfectly human. And so today, I want to invite you to the crucifixion in a different way than you probably are used to visiting it. I want you to try as best you can to go through that moment as it was seen through the eyes of his mom. This is a unique way to do it. I'm going to read you a portion of John chapter 19. Not the whole thing. Select verses from it. And I want you to imagine that you're there. Stay with me here. I want you to imagine that you're peeking behind the corner and watching Mary's face as this is all unfolding before her eyes. What would you feel if you were watching Logan go through this? Drew, Zach, or any one of your children, what if it was your child that you saw going through what Mary saw her child go through? What would be your knee-jerk reaction? I would want to run in there and rescue my boy and rip him down off that cross and take him home and bandage his wounds and take care of him. But she stood there strong. Listen to John chapter 19. You'll very rarely hear me say this, but don't turn in your Bibles yet. I just want you to listen. Just listen. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself out to be the Son of God." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. Imagine Mary watching this as it unfolds. So they took Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the place of a skull, which is called in Aramaic Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, listen to the shame, they took his garments and divided them into four parts. Imagine if these were your child's clothes. One part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things. But standing by the cross of Jesus was his mother. And his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." And then said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. Imagine, what could have possibly kept Mary standing by the cross? Could you have stood there without your knees buckling and causing you to collapse on your face, watching as your child, the one whose diaper you changed, the one who, every time he fell and skinned his knee, you would help him? What would you do if it was your child? I want you to take a look at this, and then we'll continue.
anda. Hijo, y anda. Buddy.
Buddy. You and me. Hush.
Verse 25 says, standing by the cross was his mother. Don't think for one second that a lot of eyes were not on Mary. Watching her face as she watched the cross. Don't think for one second that people weren't looking over to see, how does she have such strength? Where is she getting it from? How could she possibly stand there without collapsing under this agony of watching her boy endure this? The answer is, she couldn't. No one could. No one's that strong. No one is able to stand and watch as the greatest example of human depravity was poured out upon the man who didn't deserve what he got. No one could stand there on their own. It's only possible if God gives a special kind of grace to a person. That's the only way that's possible. No one can endure that kind of agony. My mother lost a son, my oldest brother. He didn't die on a cross, and it was crushing to my mother. A crushing blow to her. God has given a role to mothers. Not necessarily fathers, but mothers especially. An assignment that requires a special grace. They've been issued, you have been issued. If you're a mom here today, you have been issued a summons. A summons by the God who is at work calling all of humanity back to himself. The summons is this. Mom, are you willing to endure? That is the summons that God calls every mother to. A call to endure. If you're going to be a mother, you're going to live a life characterized by endurance, if you're going to do motherhood according to the way the Bible describes it. A mother's endurance endorses the love of the Father. You might want to jot that down because that's the big idea for today's message. A mother's endurance endorses the love of the Father. Said a little bit differently. The way you handle suffering, Mom, the way you handle your pain as you go through life, points to a reality about God that your kids, no matter how old they are, will see in no other way like they can as if you live it out. Your children are watching you. I don't care if they're 5 or 55. Your children are watching. They're watching and learning what faith is really all about by how Mom lives it out. They're reading the book of Mom and learning what faith is really supposed to look like. And they never stop watching. How shall a mom stand so that her children, so that her husband will see God? That's the role that God has assigned for a mom. Live in such a way that when your children look at you, eventually they stop seeing Mom and they start seeing Jesus. How can you be expected to live that way? I want to point you to three ways that are here in this text in John 19. First one, point number one. It says that she stands by the cross. Look at verse 25. But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. A mother's strength comes from her suffering. Listen carefully. A mother's strength comes from her suffering. It's built in the midst of her suffering. It's built through her suffering. You know, before I got into ministry, my wife and I owned two martial arts schools. And so we had read a whole bunch of martial arts books, and a lot of the stuff that goes along with the martial arts is not so good. We had a couple of books written by Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee died suddenly. He did not know Jesus. He was a Buddhist, and a lot of the things that he taught were contrary to the Christian faith. But, you know, I believe God gives people a glimpse of himself so that they will glorify him through their life. The question is, will you glorify him or not with the knowledge you've been given? Bruce Lee wrote something in one of his books that I thought was appropriate here. He said this: don't pray for an easy life. Pray for the strength to endure a difficult one. This is a man who didn't know Jesus. That kind of wisdom is in line with biblical wisdom. He didn't glorify God with it, and he died without knowing Jesus. But that message is absolutely true. Don't pray for an easy life, moms and dads. Pray for the strength to endure a difficult one. Living in a way that keeps you from the path of suffering keeps you from the path that leads to God. If you live in such a way that all you're trying to do is avoid suffering and avoid pain, you are walking away from the path that Jesus walked. The path of suffering, it can't be ignored, it can't be beaten, it can't be avoided. It's going to come. It wasn't that Mary had it within herself to stay strong for her son. No, her strength came from her son. Standing there and watching her boy endure that kind of suffering enabled Mary to keep standing. And guess what? The fact that he was able to endure to the end, that kind of a gift was then given over to Mary and every other person that would stand by the cross. More than anything else, this wooden structure here, even when secular people look at it, they know it stands for two things. They know when they see that symbol, whether it's hanging around somebody's neck or hanging in somebody's home, above their bed, in their office, wherever. When they see that symbol, they know it stands for two things. One, agony, suffering. This is a device of torture, but it's also a device that represents love. Those two things. It's the perfect torture device, and it is the perfect demonstration of love. Before this came, the world knew nothing about what true love was. Only when this came could the world say, that's true love. Do you know what it is? It's because someone loved other people more than he loved himself. That's what this device represents. It represents that the ultimate form of suffering, someone who will lay down his life for his friends, someone who will lay down his wife for his or her children, that is the ultimate expression of love. Suffering, a life of suffering for the sake of others, leads to the ultimate expression of love. So moms, listen carefully. If you would be willing to give up your rights for your son, for your daughter, they will come to adore that cross more than ever before. And they see it most through mom's willingness to suffer. Every mother here knows some degree of suffering. Loss of sleep. Loss of a meal. Loss of your rights. Loss of your privileges. I don't know how it works in your household, but in my household, most of those things my wife naturally responds to. When a child is awake and throwing up and hugging the toilet, Ashley runs in because they just want mom. When a child needs help and Ashley's tired and she's sick and just wants to sit down and relax, mom goes running. To be a mother is to know sacrifice more than any other role that I can think of in life. I read a sermon this week, preached in, I think, year 2000, and it was entitled, "The Call to Motherhood is the Call to Suffering." I thought, man, I thought this was my idea. But it's not. It's the truth of the Scriptures. If you want to be a mother like the way Mary was a mother, it's the call to suffering. The call to say, this is my opportunity to demonstrate for my children how deep the Father's love is for them. And they can hear it through a preacher, but they won't hear it as loudly as they will through a life lived by mom. Second thing every mom must remember so that her children see God in her life is that she doesn't stand alone. Look at verse 26. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." A woman's strength comes from Jesus, no question about it. It comes from God. But it also comes from others who are willing to stand by the cross with her. It comes from others who are willing to link arms with her and say, "We're doing this together. You can't do this alone." Mary was not left alone to endure this intense agony of watching her son suffer. She stood by and persevered with others who were sharing in that suffering. Listen close to me, moms. Doing life all by yourself is not God's definition. It's not God's definition of a strong mom. It's God's definition of a stubborn one. God didn't design you to carry the massive burden you will carry throughout your life all by yourself. This is too big of a calling to do alone. This is too big of a life to do alone. God's design was for you to know your weakness and to allow your children and your husband to see it and point to God because of it. Let me ask you a question, moms. Do you let your children know about your weaknesses? Do you let them see you cry? Do you tell them about your shortcomings? Do you let them mourn with you? Now, I used to do something that was really wrong. I used to wake up every morning and get on my knees and pray. And sometimes I would cry as I pray. Big shocker there, right? But here's what I did that was wrong. When I would hear my kids running up the steps, I'd quick jump off my knees and, "Hey, buddy, come on in." Instead of saying, "Come on in and get on your knees with me," letting him look over and be like, why is Dad crying? Here's what I did. I stripped my children of seeing how strong he is by wanting to show them how strong I am. Moms, don't do that. Don't do that. You are robbing God of the glory he's rightfully due through your story. God wants to look beautiful through your story, and you rob him of it by not letting your kids see how weak you are. Let them see the scars. Let them see the pain. Let them see the weakness. And then when they do, point to God and say, "He's the reason I'm able to stay standing." Paul said something so perfect about his own weakness. He talked about himself, and he talks about you. Take a look at this. 2 Corinthians 12:10. Let's put it on the screen, Frank. Paul said this: "That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in my weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." Paul knew how weak he was. And instead of trying to hide it and make himself look super strong to all the people that looked up to him, he gloried in it. And he said, "The weaknesses that I have are going to make God look so strong." Moms, listen. You can't keep your children from suffering. No matter how much you wish you could, suffering is going to come for them. Now, the question I want to ask you is, what do you want them to do when it comes? What effect do you want it to have on their faith when they're in a season, a deep season of suffering? What happens when your kids grow up and they have children and they lose one of them? Do you want it to strip them of their faith? Or do you want them to allow that moment of suffering to strengthen their faith like never before? That can only happen when they see mom standing by the cross in the midst of her suffering. Don't hide it from them. Allow others to come alongside you in the midst of the pain of motherhood. It's the only way your children are going to know, first of all, I don't have to do this alone. I don't have to pretend and put on a mask and make everybody think I'm super mom. Because you know what it does? It makes them think when they grow up, they have to be super mom or super dad. And then they end up being inauthentic, not genuine. And that's a quick recipe for disaster, for depression, for anxiety. Show your children how weak you are, and then when you do, glory in it. Give God the glory. Mothers, The moment that you start to believe that to rely on others is a burden to others is the moment you've stepped out of the truth and into a lie. I was talking with someone just this past week who needed help from somebody. I said, well, who have you asked? And she goes, I'm not going to. I don't want to be a burden on anyone. Goodness. When someone comes to you and asks for help, do you think, my goodness, you're such a burden? I don't think that way. I think, man, how great it is that they came to me. That took a lot of courage. That took a lot of humility. No one is going to think that of you either when you come and ask for help. Even if you're the mother of a 50-year-old, it's just as hard. Let me tell you something I've learned. The older I've gotten, the more I've realized how little I know about the things of life. The more I realize, I still need my mom. How many times have you heard me in the, 9, 10 months that we've been here? How many times have you heard me reference things I've learned from my mom? Reference the times I've seen the gospel lived out in the life of my mom. The lessons that you're teaching, just by the way you live your life, mom, into your 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, is preaching a gospel message that your children will hear far louder than they ever will by listening to me or any other preacher. They're reading the book of Mom, and it's important that you know that every day. Mom, how saturated with the gospel are you? Every single day, a mother is faced with children who are looking to them for answers. Sometimes they don't ask it outright, but they may call you on the phone and have a conversation where they're searching for something, searching for an answer by the way you answer. If you're not regularly saturating your mind with the gospel, you're going to be defenseless. Every morning, saturate your mind with the gospel and then preach it to yourself as you go through your day. You know what I mean by that? Every day, remind yourself that there's no possibility of standing or going through this life on your own, that it's by someone else's strength that you're able to endure. That's how you preach yourself the gospel. You know what that will do? It will relieve you of the burden of having to be anything other than what you really are. A weak beggar of a mom. Lord, I need your strength just to do this. How am I supposed to be strong for my kids when I don't even feel like getting out of bed today? Lord, I can't help my daughter with these questions. I didn't even know how to deal with them when I was her age. How am I going to do this? You can't. Just like Mary couldn't on her own. She needed the gospel. And so do you. And you'll crumble under the pressure if you don't preach it to yourself day in and day out. Point number three, she remains strong. Look at verse 27. Then he said to the disciple, John, behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. A mother's strength can only endure for the long haul if her mind is being renewed daily. Let me say that a little bit differently. Mother Mary would need to stand by the cross for the rest of her days. Her body would leave, for sure, but her mind would need to stay there for the rest of her life. Her heart would need to stay by the cross for the rest of her life. So why do you suppose Jesus didn't turn Mary over, his mother, to his other brothers? He wasn't an only child. He was the oldest, but he wasn't an only child. Why didn't he turn them over to James? Why John? You know why? John MacArthur wrote in his commentary that Jesus' siblings were only half-hearted believers. They kind of believed to a certain extent, but on another note, they mocked him. They really weren't fully devoted to his cause, but John was. And so hanging on the cross, choking on his own blood, he looks down and musters up the strength to say, woman, this is now the son that I'm leaving you in his care. John, my beloved disciple, I want you to adopt her as your mother. Why? Because he knows the endurance that she's going to need to continue is going to only double, triple, quadruple. He's going to be gone now, up with the Father. How is she supposed to continue to stand by the cross? If she's with her family who are kind of wishy-washy in their faith, she can't. You know what Mary needed? She needed to go to church. She needed to be in the care of John and Peter and James and all the other disciples. Because if she wasn't, she wouldn't be able to continue standing. She needed the company of others. I want you to think about this. For 33 years, Mary's mission was one thing: raise the Son of God. Imagine that. 33 years, you wake up every morning. I know what my plan is for today. You're raising the Son of God. And now all of a sudden, it's over. It's finished. His earthly ministry and mission was done. He's going to be raised 3 days later, and he's going to go up to the Father soon after that. Do you think for a moment, Mary being fully human, just like you are, do you think for a moment she might have sat alone one day at night and going, said to herself, what do I do now? Do I have any purpose anymore? I raised my son. And that's over now. Am I useless to God now? Does he have any more use for me? Some of you here today have raised your children. They're out of the house. Maybe they've got a home of their own. Maybe they've made some kids of their own. And I promise you, just from listening to my own mother, thoughts have got to creep in. Is that it? I mean, for 20-some years, all I've had was one mission. Be a mom. Raise. Now they're gone. Is this the end of my life? What do I do? The New Testament speaks one more time about Mary. That's it. After the Gospels, she appears one more time in the first chapter of Acts. Look at what it says. Acts chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. I put it up on the screen for you. It says, when they had entered the city, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. That is, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. Now here it is. These all with one mind were continually devoting themselves to prayer, along with the women, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. That's the last time the New Testament speaks about Mary. That's it. Nothing more. So let me circle back to what I asked before. What was her purpose from this point on? Why did Jesus instruct John to take care of his mother and adopt her as his own? Mary was watched that day when she stood by the cross. I guarantee you. What's his mother doing? What's her face look like? I can't believe she's standing here. And she would be continued. She would continue to be watched for the rest of her days. Jesus knew that when he turned Mary over to John and John over to Mary, this was a mutual partnership. Mary was going to be kind of like a den mother. They were going to look to her and continually watch her because she'd spent more time with the Savior than anyone else. She was going to be needed just like she was when her child was young. Moms, let me tell you, your children still need you to endure just like when they were young. If you're going to continue standing under the tremendous pressures placed on your shoulders, Mom, you must know the reason why you should. Because people are watching you. Not a single day should pass that you don't tell yourself and remind yourself of this fact. My children, no matter how old they are, they're watching how I believe. They're watching how I exercise my faith as a mom. I talked about a summons when we first started. The summons to endure to every mother. Now I want to ask you. I want to talk about three things as we conclude here. Listen carefully. God is asking you right now, moms, whether you're a young mom like my wife is, whether you're a brand new mom with a child in your arms, or whether you've been a mom 40, 50 years, there are three things that I think God is calling you to either do or renew. Listen carefully. Will you remain, mom, standing by the cross of Christ, living out the truth of the gospel by how you love people? Will you stay standing by the cross and live your life in such a way that your children will say, that is a woman who really believes? That's the first part of the summons. Second part, will you resist the temptation to be independent and let the strength of God show in your weakness? Will you resist the temptation to say, I can do this. I don't need anybody else. Besides, I can't stand hanging out with other moms anyway. I've heard that so many times. Listen, if you don't need them, maybe they need you. Don't stop meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. Instead, build up one another. Spur one another on towards love and good deeds, Hebrews says. Don't stop meeting together. Before we go on to the third part of the summons, coming to church on Sunday really isn't that much fellowship. You spend most of the time listening. Fellowship is getting together through the week and encouraging one another, calling one another and saying, how are you doing? Encourage one another. This is what it means to follow Jesus as a mom. And the third part of the summons, will you deny the impulse to trust in your own understanding and allow your mind to be transformed by the perfect parent? God is the perfect father, and you will never know how to be the right kind of mom unless you allow your mind to be transformed every day by his word. This is the summons. This is the call to mom. Let your children see you endure. You can't do it alone. And allow your mind to be renewed. I want to finish with a final exhortation. Listen to me. You can close your Bibles. You can put your pens down. If you're a mom that's going to come to this church regularly, my children, Logan and Peyton, they need you. Ashley and I, we need you. Our country needs moms right now who are really going to live their faith like they believe it, who are going to stand for the truth in the midst of incredible change. And here's what I want to encourage you with. I want to tell you to suffer. I want to tell you to suffer for your children. And when you do, I want you to sing as you suffer. Suffer, yes, endure the hardships of motherhood, but sing in such a way that your children, whether they live across the country, across the world, or they're still living in your world or in your house, they hear you sing in the midst of your suffering. Remember in Acts when Paul and another one of the disciples were locked away in prison? And as they're sitting there chained up, they were singing in the midst of their suffering, and people came to know Jesus because of it. Mom, suffer. Suffer, but sing. Sing to God and weep in front of your children and let them see, man, she's really struggling, but she praises God in the midst of it. When your children are going through a season of suffering, they will draw upon that example and they will praise God and they won't walk away from the cross. Just like Mary did. Stand by the cross. Endure the suffering of motherhood, but sing as you do. Dear God, I come to you in the name of Jesus on behalf of every mother that's in the room. I pray that you would give them the strength to endure. You told Eve, you told her that her life was going to be characterized by suffering in childbirth. It's a call to endurance. It's a call to love your children more than you love yourself. And there's nothing harder. There's nothing harder for a mom to do. There's no other role that I've seen in my life that is more characterized by self-denial than motherhood. And so, God, I honor my wife and my mom and my grandmother before the throne of grace today. And I say, on behalf of everybody in this room, thank you, God, for the example of mothers. The hardest role, in my opinion, that there is on planet Earth. And Lord, today as we continue with our families and friends to celebrate moms, I pray that you would help us to do so with thanksgiving to the one who would lay down his life so that we could come to you. It's in his name that I pray. Amen. Thank you, moms.